Your Steve Jones Show podcast will start shortly. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Brewers Outlet, your beverage supermarket on Reagan Street in Sunbury. Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motor Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Happy Friday. Happy Brewers Outlet Day, everybody, as we welcome everyone to the show. Today's show is indeed brought to you by our great friends at Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street in Sunbury, the beverage supermarket. It is the holiday season. Hey, Thanksgiving is coming up. Just a few weeks away. Christmas really is just a few weeks away. You need to start stocking up for the holidays now, and you need to start thinking about holiday gift cards now as well at Brewers Outlet. And just to stock up for this particular weekend with a lot of college football and pro football going on, you want to sit in front of that big, beautiful flat-screen TV and watch your games, do so with plenty of beverages. They have the best selection of beer, imports, domestics, microbrews, best selection anywhere, wine coolers, water, soft drinks, snacks. They roast their peanuts fresh and hot every day, and the pickle bar, all together now, is second to none. Led by the barrels, led by the dills, two of my favorites off that pickle bar at Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street in Sunbury, the beverage supermarket. I'm in the Sunbury Motors studio, Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury, Sunbury Motors, Kia Routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Tomorrow, Penn State football, Nittany Lions, and Michigan State at Spartan Stadium in East Lansing. Kickoff set for noon tomorrow, and we'll be on beginning at 10:30. Also, don't forget Bucknell's at home tomorrow at Christie. Big matchup for them. Finally, after a three-game road trip, first time they've played at home in 5 weeks. It'll be great to have them home again tomorrow as well, as they take on Lehigh tomorrow. Should be a really good matchup between the two of them. High school football coming up tonight. Playoff time. You'll hear Shikellamy at home with Athens tonight, 7 o'clock the kickoff and 6:30 the airtime. Shikellamy at home this evening. Jersey Shore will be at Selins Grove. That'll be on Eagle 107 at 7 o'clock. That's a 6 o'clock airtime. And Lewisburg is at Loyal Sock. That's on 100.9 The Valley, beginning at 7 o'clock with a 6:30 airtime this evening. Now, as you've known over time, there's, of course, the Ron Moeller tailgate is legendary. And now the Tom McGrath tailgate, run in part by Gary Goloszewski, is also now become a world-famous tailgate. Well, Penn State's on the road this weekend, and so is Gary. Now, I want to wish, and the reason I've set this up is I want to wish Amy and Gary Goloszewski all the best. They're in the Indianapolis Marathon this weekend. Amy is a great runner, so we wish them the best. I mean, Amy's out there. They're out in Indianapolis for the marathon. So we wish them nothing but the best. All right. Bob Nightengale, Dick Girardi, Chris Solari, Detroit Free Press, Neil Coulong, all on today's show. We'll talk baseball next with Bob Nightengale of USA Today here on News Radio 1070 WKOK. When it comes to car buying, there's the other guy's way, and then there's the SMC way. The other guys force you into a vehicle you really don't want. The Sunbury Motors way lets you take the time you need to browse, ask questions, and take the test drive and think on it. For over 100 years, the Mertz family and all their employees have made your experience the most pleasant one you'll ever have. The other guys won't offer you the best price for your trade, no matter how much they say they will. The SMC way is their promise to provide you with the most money the market shows your vehicle is worth. The SMC way is to offer you all applicable factory rebates on new vehicles and generous discounts. Looking for a pre-owned vehicle? The SMC way checks each vehicle in a 200-mile radius to determine the lowest price, then beat it. It's the lowest price promise, just part of the SMC way. The choice is up to you, the other guy's way or the SMC way. The SMC way wins every time. Sunbury Motors Company in the North 4th Street Auto Plaza, Sunbury, and at sunburymotors.com. Selling more cars and satisfying more customers for over 100 years.
Party time, game time, or just fun time. Doesn't matter what time it is, because it's Brewers Outlet time. The Beverage Supermarket has the area's largest beer selection. Imports, microbrews, ciders, and domestics. Pick from over 100 ice-cold 12-packs and dozens of 24-ounce singles. Soda, snacks, hot sauces, fresh roasted peanuts. Make it one-stop party shopping, and don't forget the pickle bar. So whatever you're celebrating or just doing it up, Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street, Sunbury, wants to see you. And thank you for your years of patronage.
Welcome back to the Sunbury Motors Studio. Great to have you with us. Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Kia Routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. And, of course, today's show brought to you by Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street in Sunbury, the beverage supermarket. Imports, domestics, microbrews, best selection of beer anywhere, wine coolers, water, soft drinks, snacks. They roast their peanuts fresh and hot every day, and the pickle bar is indeed second to none, led by the Barrels and the Dills. Penn State football tomorrow, Nittany Lions at Michigan State. Big game for Penn State. Noon tomorrow, we'll be on the air with the Dietz and Watson tailgate show beginning at 10:30 tomorrow morning. Baseball, hot stove time underway. Justin Upton's already signed with the Angels. 49 other players also did put their name in for free agency today. Bob Nightengale of USA Today has always been very generous with his time with us and joins us now. Bob, welcome. Thanks so much for the time.
Sure, my pleasure. Hey, Steve.
You watched this seven-game passion play out. Now you've had a chance to take a few breaths and reflect. What are your thoughts?
Yeah, it was just a very entertaining World Series. You know, was it well pitched? The relievers really struggled, but yeah, just a fabulous series, and and the best team won. I mean, Houston was a great team. Near 101 wins, and you got Justin Verlander at the trade deadline. So it's just this team can be around for a while. This team can be very scary.
You mentioned Verlander, and Verlander, once he got to Houston, went on a pretty good roll. Now, he didn't win a game in the World Series, but he was a big reason why they won the thing. Emotionally and as a veteran presence, what do you think he meant in that clubhouse with those young players?
Well, I think he just picked everybody up in the sense where, hey, we're going for it. You know, when there's no way that they're going to win the division with or without him, but they weren't going to advance the World Series without him. And I think he just picked everybody up from, you know, Dallas Keuchel to the position players, Charlie Morton. It took the load off the other starters. And having a veteran guy like that, I just think everybody got so excited that, hey, the front office believes in us that we can do it, so let's do it.
There is a point in the World Series, Yuli Gurriel, which you wrote about in USA Today. Rob Manfred was really faced with that first moment as a commissioner where he's got something really touching and significant to deal with. How do you think he did?
Yeah, I think he did fine. I know there's a lot of criticism, like, I need to be suspended during the World Series. But, you know, there's only a few games left in the World Series. I mean, you spend them for one game. You know, that would be like a $50 game suspension. By suspending him during the season, you know, those fines or penalties have usually been 2 days. So this is 2.5 times, you know, the biggest. So 5-day penalty and without pay, $330,000. If he got paid during the World Series, it would have just been no money out of his pocketbook. So, and I think he paid a price anyway, just all the embarrassment and the way he was booed at Dodger Stadium. He's going to have to live this thing for a while.
How much do you think the commissioner's decision was helped by the class with which you, Darvish, handled it?
Oh, I think big time, Steve. I think if Darvish had handled it differently, I think he would have had a serve a game suspension in the World Series. I mean, the fact that he said, hey, that's fine, it's not the first time that's happened. He kind of grew up with that in Japan with his dad, Iranian. So yeah, I think some of it was a cultural difference as well, with Gurriel not quite understanding either what some of the words meant.
Three-run leads meant nothing during the course of this. You talk about the entertainment part. That's the long ball part of it. Is that a part that you enjoy, or do you enjoy the strategy part? What do you enjoy? What's good baseball to you, Bob?
Well, I enjoy the strategy and great pitching and just the game well played. The games in Houston were so entertaining. Game five we're talking about. But yeah, at some point they really feel like real baseball, and guys are hitting one-handed home runs, balls flying everywhere. You know, it just looked like a pinball machine out there, what was going on. And so, yeah, as entertaining that was, you know, it wasn't like real baseball.
When you look at A.J. Hinch, you have to get by with what you have. He had to use a starter to close out Game 7 of the American League Championship Series, four innings, and he had to use a starter to close out Game 7 of the World Series between Good Colors and then Charlie Morton last night. What kind of interesting dynamic was it for you watching how each one of those played out?
Yeah, it was fascinating what Morton did. I mean, he won McCullers in Game 3, so he got him for Game 7 because he's a tough kid. And Charlie Morton would have been the better choice, you know, going 3-7 himself. But he came in, rescued McCullers, who had been struggling with his control, and really pitched lights out. I mean, if he had started the game, this guy might have gotten 7 or 8 innings as it was, even a short rest.
Now, we know Kershaw came in the game and pitched well. The one part that surprised, were you surprised at all that Morrow only got one batter? And because he was the next guy up, due up in the bottom half of the inning. Were you surprised by that early in the game?
Well, I know he's been worn out and stuff. You know, he could have, but you need a pinch hitter. You know, he scored some runs there. And, you know, as it turned out, it didn't matter because Kershaw went 4 innings. So if Kershaw got hit around, yeah, it would have been a mistake. But I think that bullpen's so spent. And I think they paid a price in game 2 when they took out Rich Hill way too early when he was pitching well. Their bullpen never recovered.
We know analytics plays a big role in how the Astros were built, and obviously it's playing some role in how the Dodgers go about their work. Has it been an adjustment? Now, look, analytics goes back to the beginning of time. I mean, you hit 343 at the plate, that's analytics. If you break it down further as the way you do against lefty and righties, that's analytics. So you and I both go back, and we've always had those kind of numbers. Has it taken an adjustment for you at all, Bob, or has it been easy for you to get used to how analytics work in today's game?
Well, it's an adjustment, and some of it doesn't make sense. I mean, when you pay, say, Jason Hayward, you know, getting $180 million just to play defense and hit 6 home runs, then you have a guy like Justin Upton, you know, who cranks 35 home runs, is making a lot less money. You still, I think sometimes analytics get caught up on not knowing a person's character, personality, the clubhouse culture. And those things are important. You know, and I think analytics also pays too much weight on base percentage. You know, it's like, you still got to score runs and drive them in. It doesn't matter how many times you're on base if you're standing there without doing anything else. So, analytics approach, you know, the best player in analytics history would be Eddie Goodell. You know, remember the little midget who got a walk and 1,000 on base percentage.
So, oh, you know, just, my you get, goodness. I see Bill Beck now and say, yeah, that's right, Bob.
right. Bill Beck was a genius.
Yeah, he's a genius. He knew sabermetrics long before anybody else.
right.
I was doing a game. Besides Penn State football and basketball, I also in the summer I'll do minor league baseball at the State College Spikes of the Cardinals affiliate. And Ollie Marmol, who's now the first base coach for the Cardinals, was managing the team. And they got to a game where a guy that I felt, just based traditionally, that I thought was a first or second place hitter, or maybe a 9 if you want to turn the order around, he was batting him 6th. So I asked him one day, why are you batting him 6th? And he said, in analytics, and this he's talking about the front office now talking to him, the number 2 and 6 spots in the batting order are really important. For me, Bob, that's an adjustment trying to think that way because traditionally I don't think that way. What about you with batting orders being determined, pitchers going through the third time of the order and things like that?
Yeah, I mean, you know, like the third time of the order, that's where they took out, you know, Rich Hill. And Rich Hill had the lowest, you know, the best, lowest batting average maybe in baseball going through the order 3 times. Yeah, I think what it likes does is just run by computer. It takes away kind of what you're seeing with your own eyes and stuff like that. I mean, I don't need to see a computer or scouts against a computer say, you're talking about exit velocity and things like that. Hey, when a guy gets a line drive, I know it's good exit velocity. You know, sometimes those things hurt. You know, it's like, you know, with the way that exit velocity is now, a guy gets penalized if he has one or two bloop hits in a game. I mean, it's better to strike out if your exit velocity.
Right.
So, yeah, some of that stuff is out of control. And I think, you know, we're seeing the managers just don't have the same power as they used to. And some of these things are being run by front offices. You know, well, let's watch to see who the Yankees hire as their manager. You know, I guarantee you someone that's going to be just, you know, taking direction from whatever they want the lineups to be and everything else.
Yeah, and that was going to actually be my next point, Bob. I was wondering, is Joe Girardi in some ways, not completely, but in some ways a victim of not being an analytics-era guy?
You know, the funny thing is he kind of is. I mean, he's into it a lot more than other guys. But he won. I mean, Dusty Baker, yeah, he's not an analytic guy, but he won 95 and 97 games and two division titles. So some of the stuff is just, it doesn't make sense.
Okay, what's the offseason going to be like? This is not a lot of offseason here. Obviously, the winter meetings are coming up in Orlando in a bit, and there's going to be free agency and so forth. But is this will be a little bit of a time for you to decompress a bit? And if so, how do you?
Yeah, it's just never ends, really. I mean, the GM meetings start in a week in Orlando. 2 weeks later, you have the winter meetings. So you still have the hot stove thing. I mean, even, you know, this morning I get a call at 9:15 to say, hey, by the way, we're about to sign Justin Upton to his new contract. You know, I just woke up in the World Series, and now it's the hot stove league.
Bob, you know, we've seen what's happened with the NFL. The NBA's done better as well. What do you think baseball's positioned itself now, especially after the last two, you know, seasons where the Cubs won dramatically, the Astros won dramatically, it was entertainment. What do you think baseball is now, right now?
I do think the ball is juiced. But I think the way the baseball was, the high-scoring games, I think it's very popular. I mean, TV ratings were high, not as high as the Cubs a year ago, but still very high. You know, they had some weather problems this year with a lot of rain, but still tennis is, you know, top five or top six of all time. So I think it's very, very popular sport. And, you know, and you watch in about 2 weeks here, we're going to see the implementation of a pitch clock, limit visits to the mound, and everything else. So I'm going to try to speed this thing up.
And I want to ask you about that. Is that between that possibility and then fewer mound visits, which are essentially your timeouts, is it something you endorse and is good for the game, or are you okay with the pace of what we're seeing?
I'm okay with the pace. You know, I mean, that game we had in the 10-inning game in Game 5, that was almost 5 hours, but it was entertaining 5 hours. I mean, it was a blast to watch. And what slows it down, of course, you have a well-pitched game and a catcher goes to the mound incessantly. That there's no need for that. Sometimes that can really slow the game down. You know, I think the pitch clock, I don't think it's that big a deal. You know, I do think that pitchers will adjust to it in a hurry, because you're talking to minor league guys that come up and they've been pitching with it. They say you get used to it.
Absolute pleasure. I know you had to take some time the day after doing a lot of work to come on and the show and talk with us, and I appreciate it very much. Great respect for your work, Bob. Thank you so much.
Sure, my pleasure. Thanks, Steve.
Bob Nightengale, USA Today. Appreciate his time very, very much. Next half hour, we'll take a look at the Nittany Lions and Michigan State. Chris Solari covers Michigan State for the Detroit Free Press. He has always been very generous with his time with us. We look forward to hearing from him in just a few moments. Bottom of the hour, time for news. Today's show brought to you by Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street in Sunbury, the beverage supermarket. We're in the Sunbury Motors studio. Great to have you with us today on this Friday here on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Welcome back, Sunbury Motors Studio, here on this Friday. Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in beautiful Hummel's Wharf. And, of course, today's show brought to you by Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street in Sunbury, the beverage supermarket. You know, I mentioned Sunbury Motors. Great time to think about buying that holiday car. It's also a great time at Brewers Outlet to think about getting those holiday gift certificates from Brewers Outlet. Imports, domestics, microbrews, best selection of beer anywhere. Wine coolers, water, soft drinks, snacks. They roast their peanuts fresh and hot every day. The bags are right there at the register. And the pickle bar is indeed, yes, all together now. Car, office, wherever you may be, the pickle bar is second to none. Thanks for joining in. Led by the Dills and the Barrels at Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street in Sunbury, the beverage supermarket. I shouldn't have mentioned the Bills after the thrashing they took last night at the hands of the New York Jets, 34-21. It wasn't even that close. The Bills scored 14 points late when it was 34-7 at one point. All right. Playoff time tonight here on News Radio 1070 WKOK. It'll be Athens and Chicoutimi. Kevin Herr and the coach Dick Hort with the call. 6:30 the airtime, 7 o'clock the kickoff. Meanwhile, over at Eagle 107 tonight, it'll be Sealands Grove against Jersey Shore. 7 o'clock the kick, 6 o'clock the airtime. Don't forget Sean Carey, area's best postgame show afterward on Eagle 107. Not only that, I think it's the best high school football postgame show in the state, let alone just the area. That's, you know, statewide, I haven't heard a better one statewide. And on 100.9 The Valley tonight, Loyal Sock will be at home taking on Lewisburg this evening on 100.9 The Valley. And don't forget Bucknell football tomorrow at home. They've got Lehigh tomorrow. Finally back home for Bucknell after a three-game road swing. This day in sports history, then Chris Solari of the Detroit Free Press, who covers Michigan State football. 1929, Providence became the first NFL team to host a game at night. They used floodlights in a game against the Chicago Cardinals. 1948, Gordie Howe of the Detroit Red Wings made the first of his 21 All-Star appearances. 1953, the Rules Committee of Organized Baseball restored the sacrifice fly. The rule had not been used since 1939. What it did was is that when you drove in a run, they changed the rule back so it would not count as an at-bat. 1972, Joe Namath was featured on the cover of Life magazine. For all the young people out there, you're asking right now, what the heck was Life magazine? 1989, the Minnesota Timberwolves played their first NBA game. They lost to the Seattle Supersonics 106-94. The Sonics are now the Oklahoma City Thunder. 1989, Lou Piniella was named the manager of the Cincinnati Reds, replacing the banned Pete Rose. Piniella led the Reds to the World Series championship in 1990. Greg Maddux of the Braves became the first player to win back-to-back Cy Young Awards on different teams. He won the Cy Young with the Cubs in 92 and with the Braves in 93. Fleet Center, Rose Garden, Sky Dome hosted their first NBA games on this date in 1995, and the great Jerry Rice in 1996 became the first NFL player with 1,000 career receptions. Penn State, Michigan State tomorrow. Spartan Stadium in East Lansing, big game for the Nittany Lions tomorrow at noon. We'll be on with the Dietz and Watson tailgate show tomorrow beginning at 10:30. I'm very pleased to be joined by the beat writer who covers Michigan State for the Detroit Free Press, Chris Solari. Chris, welcome back. It's always great to hear you on the other end.
Yeah, great to hear you guys too. Thanks, Steve. Appreciate it.
Chris, we saw Michigan State last year, and we see them now. What has changed? Is it getting older, or were there changes?
Well, I think a little bit of it is getting older. I think, obviously, Brian Lewerke getting a little bit of experience last year helped. Those two defensive tackles, and Mike Panasiuk and Raekwon Williams, they've kind of become disruptors up the middle. So I think that experience has helped. But I think a lot of it, too, is just an attitude change. We talked about this before. They've had so many off-field issues in the offseason. I think 13 different guys are gone that could have been back this year. A couple of them went to the NFL, but 11 of them were either dismissed or left the program. So that's a lot of attrition. But I think Mark D'Antonio has used the phrase reset quite a bit since the summer. And I think there was an attitude reset with this group. I mean, they saw what happened last year in letting one loss turn into two losses, turn into five losses. And that's been the key. This team has been able to operate, you know, one game at a time vacuum, which, you know, coaches preach that, but but going from preaching to execution is certainly a whole different thing. And maybe this group's a little bit younger and doesn't know what's ahead of them in a lot of ways, too. So they just stay focused on the task at hand. And I think that's been really the key.
Chris, let's get into Brian Lewerke for a moment. He's not only coming off a record-setting performance in the triple overtime game against Northwestern, he's also the second leading rusher in his team. What has he done in terms of presence, and also what is his movement in the pocket meant to keep plays alive?
That's really what it is. I mean, a lot of what he can do with his legs helps set up some of the pass, but at the same point, they've been using a lot more run-pass options. And really, I mean, I can't think of back, maybe back to Drew Stanton was the last Michigan State quarterback with this kind of mobility where he could extend plays, where he can, you can design runs for him, whether it's quarterback draws, whether it's running a sprint option, whether it's kind of using that little sprint out and pull back pass. And there's so many different things that Lewerke's been able to do. And, you know, you see sometimes the youth and inexperience, he tends to make some bad decisions in throwing into double coverage and down the field. He's still struggling with his touch on the deep passes. But last week against Northwestern, they were shooting for them. He just overshot his receivers a couple times. But at the same point, you know, when the passes are needed to be thrown, he's able to hit them. I mean, they gave him basically the entire out to work with in that last drive of regulation, and he led them down the field. In the beginning of the game, on the first drive of the game, he hit a deep ball to Cody White. He showed his legs in running for a first down, but mostly he did it with his arm in those two drives. And I think that he's becoming more comfortable in terms of the passing game. And there were a couple games in there in this mid part of the season where coaches were just emphasizing run, 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 and didn't allow him to build any type of rhythm. But in that Northwestern game, you saw what maybe the future lies for Brian Lewerke. I mean, he's a guy that can stretch the field if you need him to. He can run it, and he can throw it.
So I want to get to the wideout group. It's a big group. I mean, in terms of size.
Yeah.
Then you add Cody White in there, true freshman who's coming off a 165-yard receiving performance. Another guy with really good size. With White now in there with primarily Stewart and Davis, has that changed the dynamics of what we're seeing in the Michigan State passing game?
I think a little bit. You know, Cody White's a big physical kid for a true freshman. He's 6'3". He plays aggressive. And I think where he showed up to me most early in the season was in downfield blocking. They brought him in specifically on some run plays and some deeper pass plays to just block. And he plays with an edge to him. And now you're seeing a little bit more with speed. You're seeing a little bit more him getting separation and understanding the route concept. I mean, you know, his dad played in the NFL and worked for the Detroit Lions, Sheldon White. He works at Michigan State now. He was there last year as an advisor, and they promoted him this year. But this is a guy that's been around the program. He understands the program for a true freshman, and he understands the concept of what they want a receiver to be in terms of blocking and being physical. And the other guys, I mean, Felton Davis is a big guy, a big target at 6'4". He knows how to use his body. I think, you know, he might not have blazing speed, but he is a very adept at creating separation with long arms and using his hind end to seal off defenders. And Darryl Stewart's become kind of I think back to when Derek Mason was here, you know, 20-some years ago, where, you know, if you needed a catch, you were throwing the ball to him. And I think that's where Darryl Stewart is right now. He had 11 catches in that game against Northwestern. He's had some big games this year. So those guys are the three top guys. The other two guys who've really been in the rotation and been Tristan Jackson, who kind of lost his starting job with White's emergence. He's kind of struggled. He was the star of the spring, but he showed some downfield speed. And the other guy is Hunter Risen, Andre Risen's son. He's slowly developing into a little bit more of a role. But when you have that many guys, and Cam Chambers is the sixth guy in that group, they've been targeting. But when you have that many guys, I mean, it's options for Lewerke. And I think the one thing that he's done really well this year is spread the ball around to the receivers. You know, I think there was 8 or 9 guys that he hit in that Northwestern game. So he's got the vision and trust in his receivers. Sometimes, though, I think it's just with him in the passing game, he gets a little maybe excited and overshoots his receivers and hasn't quite developed that touch just yet. But, you know, that is something that comes with experience in games.
You mentioned the two defensive tackles and how important they've been. What have those two guys meant to the linebackers?
Oh, a ton. I mean, you know, you think about all the plays that Joe Bocci has been making as the middle linebacker as a sophomore. So much of that is predicated by that push up front by Mike Panasiuk and Raekwon Williams. I mean, they're true disruptors, and now Naquan Jones is kind of rounding into the mix as the third guy. He had a real impressive game, probably his best game of the season at Northwestern, is just getting in there and pushing the pocket back. And I think that's allowed the linebackers like Bocci and Chris Fry and Andrew Dow to get out in space and make some plays. Now, last week against Northwestern, they were struggling. I think that had nothing really to do maybe with the middle guys. I think that was the lack of edge pressure that Michigan State was getting. And consequently, the linebackers were mismatched in some coverage situations that Clayton Thorson exposed. Fry in particular was torched a couple times. And, you know, they had some safety missed assignments and help. But, you know, I do think that they've helped those linebackers a ton. And Joe Bocci has just been a stud at linebacker. I mean,
yeah.
You know, he had some issues in tackling in Northwestern that really have been the rarity, you know, for a kid who played a little bit last year as a true freshman and then takes over the keys of the defense this year. He's been a force, and he's shown some speed. He's shown some you know, agility. He's made some forced fumbles and got an interception. So, I mean, this is a guy that to bear watch this week.
Yeah, Bocci and Fry are two guys that, to me, are definitions of downhill linebackers. Would that be fair?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, Fry in particular, I mean, sometimes it betrays them and they get a little over-aggressive and they whiff on some tackles. That was the weird thing, seeing Bocci last week really just whiff badly on a screen pass to Justin Jackson. So I think coming off that game, the job that Jackson did, I mean, everybody knows what Saquon Barkley can do, and I think Justin Jackson's kind of a Saquon Barkley light in some ways, in terms of the things he brings to an offense. So between Barkley and Gesicki, those two guys are going to be needed to do a lot more than they did this week. They're going to be required to play a little bit better in coverage, and same with the safeties too. I mean, if they're going to have to pass off the Gesicki to those safeties, David Dowell got picked on quite a bit last week by Thorson, and Kari Willis is more of your downhill
right.
kind of safety that Michigan State likes against run support. So I think that, you know, there's some challenges that are going to be there for this Michigan State team. And we saw what McSorley did last year to Michigan State at Beaver Stadium. I mean, he beat them over the top over and over again in that second half. So that they're well aware of the challenges that are ahead.
I think it's fair to say in the last 10 years there have been very few teams in the Big Ten, if not nationally, that have better corner play than Michigan State does. I've always felt that the really good corner play for Michigan State gave them the option to do whatever they wanted with the other nine guys out there, and that made them very hard to play against. Where's their corner play right now?
You know, that's probably one of the areas where they're so far ahead of the curve between age and experience and production. I do think that the two guys they've been running out there now is the primary guys in Josiah Scott and Justin Lane. You're talking a true freshman in Scott, who was a three-star recruit, so he's not, you know, he fell under the radar, but he has played like a five-star recruit this year at the corner spot. And I think he got torched on a crossing route but had no safety help behind him against Northwestern for that go-ahead touchdown in triple overtime. But he's been outstanding in coverage. I mean, teams have just not really tried to go his way. And Justin Lane's a big guy that came here as a receiver from Cleveland. He's a four-star receiver, but they switched him out of need last year to cornerback. And he has become, you know, he's 6'2". He's got some length to him. He's got some speed. He's got receiver speed, knows the routes that receivers like to run. He's kind of he's quietly, because Scott has been such a force and a surprise, Justin Lane has quietly become another one of those guys, like almost like a Tony Lippett when they flipped him back over the defensive side, where he's just
right.
ball-hawking and kind of smothering receivers.
Why all the issues on kick coverage? Because you know what it is. They're 113 in that department out of 130.
Yeah.
Why all the issues?
I think some of it has to do with the youth. I mean, that's they want to make sure they're playing 13 true freshmen right now, and a number of those kids are playing on the coverage units. Guys like Dom Long and Trey Pearson, and I think Scott's been in on the kick coverage. So I think some of it's inexperience. Some of it has to do with the leg of Brett Scanlon. I mean, he hasn't been able to really reach the end zone, so you're seeing fewer touchbacks and not giving his guys enough of a chance to get down there. But kick coverage has been an issue for Michigan State for a couple years. I think back to even the 2015 year, they go to the college football playoff, and, you know, I think Alabama ran a punt back on them. I know Western Michigan in the opener, Darius Phillips that year ran one back on him, and he ran one back again this year, so he was a known commodity. That's been kind of an Achilles heel for this program here for the last couple of years. But this year in particular, I think that you're seeing it just – some of it's just the youth that they're rolling out there, that they feel that they need to get these guys experience, and that's the best spot for them right now.
Well, your thoughts on Saturday's game?
Well, I haven't really thought too much ahead. You know, I think back to last year and how surprising it was to see Michigan State ahead at halftime in that game. And then basically after Damian Terry got knocked out of that game, everything devolved. I mean, it was an emotional letdown to see him get hurt for that team. And then everything just kind of fell apart, like the whole season. You know, they surprised a lot of people, I think, being in that game. So I expect it to be a competitive game. I expect it to me. I kind of liken it to how the Ohio State game was last year. Nobody gave Michigan State a chance against the Buckeyes when they came in here to East Lansing, but, you know, they summoned up maybe their best performance of the year. And I think this team knows that to be competitive with Penn State, maybe not to win, because I think that one thing Mark D'Antonio, aside from having that funny little interaction with the telephone at the podium last week in the Northwestern press conference, I think that, you know, he came in there satisfied for a guy that just got out of a triple overtime loss, simply because those guys were so competitive and you know, managed to get themselves back into the game and maybe showed a maturity beyond their years. So I think that I kind of expect one of the game. I don't know if Michigan State has enough to really beat Penn State at this point, but I think that, you know, they'll be more competitive than they were a year ago.
I have one last question, Chris, and this is an aside from what we've been talking about, but you saw Notre Dame in person, and they put together a very good performance that night in East Lansing. What's your thoughts on Notre Dame and seeing how it's playing out for them since you've seen them in person?
Well, I think they've matured considerably. I think some of that was due to Michigan State's own issues. I think they shot themselves in the foot quite a bit in that game. Turnovers really hurt them. I think that Notre Dame, and I don't think Wimbush was that great in that game either, but I do think that as the season has progressed, I think Notre Dame has started to develop their run game. They've managed to be physical on defense, and I think, to me, I don't want to say it's a surprise, but I think that they've matured maybe a little faster than I thought they would. I wasn't overly impressed with them in that game, even though they beat Michigan State by 20, if that makes any sense, because I think some of that was Lewerke mm-hmm. making some mistakes as a young quarterback. But hey, sure. Notre Dame, you can't argue with the job that they're doing right now in improving week by week since that Georgia loss.
Hey, thanks so much, Chris. I appreciate all the time you gave us today. I'm looking forward to seeing you Saturday.
Anytime, Steve. We'll see you out there.
Chris Solari, Detroit Free Press. We thank him very much for his time. He's always been generous with his time for us, whether we're talking Michigan State football or Michigan State basketball. And Chris does an outstanding job with the Detroit Free Press of covering both. High school football tonight, plenty of it across the area. It is playoff time, and we'll have it completely covered for you here on the Sunbury Broadcasting family of stations. The one we'll have here on News Radio 1070 WKOK, the award-winning Kevin Herr on the call tonight, along with Dick Hort, the coach. They'll be at Shikellamy tonight, and the Shikellamy Braves will host Athens this evening in the opening round of the playoffs. 7 o'clock will be the kickoff. 6:30 will be the airtime tonight. Meanwhile, on Eagle 107, beginning at 6 o'clock this evening with a 7 o'clock kickoff, Sealands Grove will be in action hosting Jersey Shore. Pat O'Brien, Ryan Brandt with a call on that one. And, of course, Lewisburg will be at Loyal Sock this evening. That's on 100.9 The Valley. That's a 7 o'clock kickoff and a 6:30 airtime. Don't forget on Eagle 107 tonight, Sean Carey, best post-game show anywhere in high school football. Next half hour, Dick Girardi from Del Mar as we continue on News Radio 1070 WKOK.